Hello and welcome to the United Methodist Church of the Dunes online worship experience. I'm Pastor Lou Grettenberger, the lead pastor of the church. We hope that you find our service a blessing today as you join us for worship. At this time, Carla, our communications director, will share a little bit about the ministry of our church and how to access things related to this service.
Hi. While the church building may be closed, there is still so much work happening in the life of the church. Just this past week, the finishing touches were put on a project that will allow the church to more quickly and efficiently send emails to all members and friends of Church of the Dunes. Then, thanks to the work of some members and staff, a survey was put together. The survey designed to gather input about a return to in-person worship. The survey was connected to the new email platform and sent out, and survey results began coming back almost immediately. Of course, as happens every week, a worship service was carefully and thoughtfully prepared. A bulletin was put together with the order of the worship service and announcements. And these things are all just the tip of the iceberg of the many things that happen each week in the work of the church. Now here we are at the most important part of the church week, our worship service. Thank you for being here. Let's join Pastor Lou.
At this time, I invite you to join me in our call to worship as we read it responsively. Come, let us worship the Lord our God. For the Lord is our God, and we are the Lord's people. As we wait upon the Lord, let us open our ears that we might both hear and heed the word of the Lord. As we wait upon the Lord, let us open our eyes that we might both see and perceive the will of the Lord. As we wait upon the Lord, let us open our hearts, that we might understand with our hearts and turn to the Lord for healing. Will you join me now in singing, Oh, for a Thousand Tongues to Sing. Children's message, and I was hoping that if your children aren't with you right now, that you might bring them into the room and share with them this time so that I can share with them a message about God's love. Today I have kind of an ordinary thing. It's from our home, and what do you call this, boys and girls? Do you remember? Can you see it? It's called an extension cord, right? And an extension cord is something that connects, this side connects with the wall, which is the power, and then this side connects to the plug in a device or a lamp or a fan or something like that. I was thinking about how God is the power of our lives today, that having we're learning about having Christ within us, but in order to have God's power within us, we need to somehow be connected to God. And so first, we have to be plugged in to the power of God. But we know that sometimes God feels kind of far from us. And we're over here and we want that power, so we need to plug into the other end. And I was thinking that the extension cord is the gift that we had in Jesus. When Jesus came into the world, he connected us with God, the power of the universe. And then we connected with Jesus, and Jesus empowered us to do the things that he did. I hope that when you're feeling kind of not like a very bright light or a very powerful engine or machine, that you will know that if you want to work for God, if you want to do something for God and you're struggling, you just need to call on Jesus, and Jesus will extend God's power to you. Will you pray with me, please? Dear God, remind us that when we are in Jesus Christ, we have the power of God flowing in us, and we can do all things through that God who strengthens and empowers us. Amen. Will you join me now in our prayer of confession? God, forgive us when we are shallow, seeking a quick blessing or a fast favor from you, without being willing to invest fully in a trusting, committed relationship with you. Forgive us when we are one-sided, asking always for mercy and compassion, but not returning the same. Forgive us when we approach you, begging for guidance and direction, but then neglect to follow your instructions. Forgive us when we cry out with our pressing questions, but then stop listening for your answers. Spirit, search our hearts as we quiet them before you, that we may confess our sin and receive forgiveness. Amen. Hear these words of good news. There is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set us free from the law of sin and death. Since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Thanks be to God. At this time, we will join in our time of offering. I hope that you will take this opportunity to write a check to the church or to share through online giving your gifts to our God through our ministry. Will you join me in our prayer of dedication as you see it before you? God of the universe, we come to worship this morning, longing to set our minds on the Holy Spirit, to live with Christ within us. We have not always made room for Christ in the clutter of our lives. We have indulged our wants so often that too often the voice of the Spirit is drowned out. As we dedicate these gifts this morning, may it help us to live more in tune with the Spirit and to use our resources in a way that reflects that Christ is Lord of all our lives. In his holy name we pray. Amen.
Our first reading this morning is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13, verse 1 through 9 and 18 through 23. That same day Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil, and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen." Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while, and when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and it yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
In the Bible, Paul's letter to the church at Rome, chapter 8, verses 1 through 11. There is therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh. And to deal with sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, so that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on the things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh. You are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through the Spirit that dwells in you. May God bless this reading from Holy Scriptures. Will you pray with me, please? Dear Lord, we come finding ourselves grateful to engage in your scriptures, to be reminded of the core truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that there is no condemnation from you, no judgment, because of your grace. Help us to learn how to spread that truth, that love to others as we listen for your word and words today. In Jesus' name, amen. One of my favorite authors as a child was Robert Louis Stevenson. He wrote, "Don't judge each day by the harvest you reap, but by the seeds you plant." In our gospel lesson this morning, I think we will find that that Jesus agrees with Robert Louis Stevenson, or at least we should say that Robert Louis Stevenson's writings were in sync with what Jesus shares in the story. Our job as disciples of Jesus Christ is to share the message of God's gospel, of God's love in Jesus Christ. What is interesting for me is the rabbinic precision with which Jesus works today. He drops the meaning of the story into the story in a way that the listener is drawn in and then convicted by the story. Jesus certainly tells an interesting story, hoping to invite people to listen and to tell the good news to others. He explains in the story that for a variety of reasons, the story of God's love will not take root in some life, using the metaphor of seed planting. But simultaneously, as he is preaching the message, he is telling everybody, broadcasting, you might say, to this group of people, the very message that's packed in the story, and then they're experiencing. See, Jesus had pulled out into the water, and from there the crowds had gathered, and they were listening for his message, and he was literally broadcasting it. There was no sound system, no recording devices, no microphones, no amplification. He spoke the message, he broadcast it, and he was broadcasting it to a large crowd. He begins his message with listen and hope that they would not only listen but respond. In fact, he ends his message with listen as well. But he understands that many will hear and not respond for a whole variety of reasons. And he explains those reasons in the allegory that he shares in the parable. The message planted in rocky ground and little soil grows quickly. So everybody gets excited, but then it dies because it has no deep roots. Seeds planted where weeds are located or other seeds of weeds get choked out. The message gets trampled and eaten when the seeds are planted on the path. But those seeds planted in fertile soil grow and yield much fruit. He was hoping that his listeners would realize that they were the soil. They could choose what kind of soil to be, receptive or not receptive, and also to realize that as they went to share the message, that they would find a similar trouble that Jesus was even that day as he broadcast the message to those who were willing to listen. He wants his listeners to be both good soil, receptors, receivers of the grace and the message of Christ, and good planters, wildly throwing the seed everywhere, broadcasting in hopes that some of those seeds would grow. Marion Wright Edelman reminds us how important it is for persons to plant seeds in other people's lives. She writes this, "Children must have at least one person who believes in them. This could be a counselor, a teacher, a preacher, a friend. It could be you. You never know when a little love, a little support will plant a small seed of hope," unquote. I want you to take a few minutes this morning to think about and to remember those persons who have planted seeds in your life. Let's just pause and meditate on that for a moment. It may be someone who has passed away. I want you to take this moment to say thank you to God for that person in your life. Now maybe think of someone who is still alive. Get the name in your mind. Picture their face. Someone who has planted the seeds of love and faith and confidence and hope in your life. Now, if you've got a pen handy, jot down that name as a reminder to send a personal note to that person or make a call or at least a comment when you see them the next time. Finally, in response to those seeds that have been planted in your life, I invite you to make a commitment to move from seed bearer, receiver, to seed planter. Think about one person's name, one life that you want to plant the seed of hope and faith in, and make a note again to do something about it. If God has impacted you through someone, pay it forward. Know that it made a difference in your life, and you can make a difference in someone else's life by a kind word, a note, an encouragement, an opportunity to help set a vision for someone's life, and certainly to let them know that they are loved and cared about. So what is the seed that Jesus invites us to plant? The message Jesus invites us to broadcast is wrapped, I think, today in Paul's theological treatise that we call the Epistle to the Romans, or the Book of Romans. We find packaged in this passage today a mind-blowing, spirit-freeing truth that starts with a simple transitional word, therefore. Everything up to this moment in Romans has led to this moment of verse 1 of chapter 8 of this book. Therefore, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. Life in Jesus, or life in the Spirit, frees us from the limiting, oppressing immaturity of life under the law. Now, those words combined together may surprise you, but law is set as a limit for those who are driven and unable to avoid temptation. The temptations we are told in the scriptures today, of the sarx, that is one word in Greek used for the flesh. And it doesn't refer necessarily just to the human body, but it refers to the worldly nature of who we are. For those motivated by the Spirit who are in Christ, law becomes unnecessary. We are free from the law. Now, we've already touched on this before. This doesn't mean that we are freed from the law, that sin might abound, that we might be able to do whatever we want. No, that the motivation of the very heart of who we are, our souls change. Think of a great bowler. Maybe it's you. Is there any need to put gutter blockers down when you have a great bowler that is bowling? Of course not. The pro throws the ball down the center of the lane, seldom scooting it off to the side, maybe once in a while, but almost never hitting a gutter ball. A life in the center of God's love, or in Christ, isn't motivated by legalistic boundary keeping, but by a desire and power which motivates us to be effective and eager participants in the way of Christ, or what we call the kingdom of God. When we reset our minds, this new mindset is not one of fleeing from a condemning God of judgment. That is not our motivation. Instead, it is a lover's response to a wooing God whose love knocks us off our feet and makes us want to live exclusively for the beloved. It is not we who are condemned, in fact, by the life and death of Jesus Christ, but the law itself by which we once lived that is condemned to death. Because law becomes unnecessary. Legalisms can go out the door. Legalisms and law give way to resurrection of life in the Spirit. This is not a new way for God that we might think that Jesus suddenly provides a new way. But it is the receiving of the truth that we have always been beloved by God, that we were confused and thought that following the jot and tittle of the law would solve life's problems. It certainly helps us as we're learning. But the fertile soil of the heart, finally allowing Christ's Spirit to operate and control us, move us. When we allow God's love to take root and grow within us, a new birth happens. Not a new birth of the law, but a birth of grace. Megan Dodd, in her book, Meditations with Teresa of Avila, says, just as the bond between child and parent is never severed, nothing can dissolve the eternal bond between a soul and the beloved. That is the one we know or call God. Romans 8 is the clear response to the question that is found in Romans 7. Paul says, wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? This is what Paul asks. Paul had struggled in bondage to the law of sin and the laws of God. We don't know the details of the sin he struggled with, those things that he tried not to do. But we do see how he was caught up in the legalisms of his faith. He says that he did the things he wished he wouldn't do, and he didn't do the things he knew were right. In righteous zeal, we find him persecuting Christians in the book of Acts. He stood by as Stephen, a Christian leader, was stoned to death for being of another faith because he thought the laws of his faith precluded the way Stephen trusted and followed God. Isn't it interesting that God frees us both from our selfish, righteous religiosity and the commission of sins? That's what this therefore is about, freeing us from those things, from the motivations that are not from the love of who God is, but in response to a kind of terroristic view of who God is. This is the message that Jesus wants to broadcast today. Praying all the time that the seed of Jesus' love and message will take root in our hearts, that have been mulched in the fertile seedbeds of God's love. But in the end, we are not judged each day by the harvest we reap, but by the seeds we plant. I invite you today to plant seeds of no condemnation in the lives of everyone you possibly can, so that they too might know the grace and the love of our beloved. Amen. I invite you now to pray to our God. Oh God, we thank you and we love you for the great grace that was supplied to us in Jesus Christ. We don't understand the details or mechanics, but we understand, oh Lord, somehow with our hearts that when you say there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, it means that everything's going to be okay. And we thank you for that, God. For those in our midst today who are listening to this message and this service who have not heard that good news, I pray that they might accept you into their hearts, that they might understand that having the Spirit of Christ within them is transforming and new life-giving. For those of us who have experienced it already, but sometimes forget, we have spiritual amnesia, remind us that this isn't about following the jot and tittle of the law. It's about accepting your Spirit and life within us, that the resurrected power of Jesus Christ might transform our lives. We need you, God, today. As you pour yourself into our lives, as you plant seeds of hope and love and peace and justice, we pray that we might be fertile soil ready to accept your planting, your grace in our lives, in our spirit. Bless us. Keep us whole. Keep us conscious of your spirit within us. Keep us loving as you first loved us. Keep us reaching out even as we are unable to get out much these days. Keep our minds and our spirits stayed on you. We pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, let us sing our last song together, In Christ Alone. To this place today, needing the Spirit of Christ. We have become fertile soil for God's Word, and God has planted God's own self in us. Go to be born anew to the living hope and grace that only Jesus Christ can be and bring to us. Go to share that with others. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.